the third part in our storytelling triumvirate. Also, similar to Chef Paul Paré, has two restaurants in the Asia's 50 Best Restaurants list from 2015. They are Nihonbashi and the Ministry of Proud, both in Colombo, Sri Lanka. Half Sri Lankan and half Japanese, he has transported elements of his personal background into his cooking to create a new culinary language. Please welcome Chef Darshan Munidasa.
Fellow chefs, restaurateurs, ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. It's a huge honor to address this prestigious group that makes Asia's 50 Best today. We are all storytellers. Every day, our blank pages are our plates that is played up one at a time. But today, let me try saying words. In Japan, I belong to a group I ironically refer to as half. We are only half Japanese. But in reality, we are twice. We think and count in two languages. Our palates switch from one to another mode subconsciously. We have two mindsets, which result in opposing dispositions when it comes to mannerisms and body language. Intrinsically, our comfort foods and cravings stemming from our ethnic diversities are. We are not merely bilingual, but we are bicultural. Add to this English, and a third palette emerges. Ingredients, comfort foods, cravings, anything and everything seem to have one more dimension, such as language of dreams, counting methods, even how you use your fingers counting, changes from culture to culture. And suddenly we are trilingual and tricultural. Japanese and Sri Lankan food are as diverse as it gets. Both countries, island nations, share the teachings of the Buddha, tea-growing countries, and both countries traditionally catch and consume tuna. And this, all of this makes this bond unique, strong, deep-rooted, and historic. Today, I would like to believe Nihonbashi has contributed to make this connection stronger. And here is a glimpse of what Nihonbashi is today. Nihonbashi opened in 1995, and the reasons I chose this name were, one, Nihonbashi is a district in Tokyo where I was born in, and it's the name of the most important bridge in Japan. Three, it also means Japan Bridge, and from that day, from day one of the restaurant opened, that's what I aspired to do, to bridge these two island nations that I proudly call homes. In 2014, the Japanese government recognized me for spreading Japanese cuisine culture around the world. An award was given to 5 individuals every year. It was an amazing feeling to be a part of this group, and I felt I really did bridge this country's culinary. Nihonbashi is 21 years old today, and was born during a dark time of Sri Lankan history. Yet we plated every day as suicide bombs went off around us. Sri Lanka has also stupendously high import tax, and it still does, and makes any import expensive, even prohibitive. It was this negative attribute of Sri Lanka that drove me to the coastal belts of the island, and I found whole big-eyed tuna and yellowfin tuna being graded. We are the best at testing for tsukiji and secondary markets of the UK and Europe. Japanese culture has a strong emphasis of appreciating nature. This is true in appreciating the natural harvest from the oceans, blossomings of sakura, which is about to happen, the amazing hues of autumn leaves in ikebana, the colors and patterns of nishikoi, Japanese gardens of rock, moss or sand, and even the term wabi-sabi. The philosophies of bonsai and the quest for perfection have in a way helped create amazing vegetables and crazy fruits in Japan. These are sometimes priceless as the bonsai itself. Japanese culture is about simplicity and minimalism. And in this simplicity lies a complexity that is almost diabolic. How can 15 stones in a rock garden in Kyoto mean so much? How can a manicured 6-inch pine tree, 100 years old, have so much character? How can the simple folds of square paper create amazing objects? This is what Japanese culture is symbolized in one kanji character. It's the same word as in washoku, Japanese cuisine, washitsu, Japanese room, wagashi, Japanese confectionery, wagasa, Japanese umbrellas, wafuku, Japanese clothing, and wagyu. Wagyu means Japanese cattle or Japanese beef. With strict guidelines of species, upbringing, and most importantly, being in Japan. Unfortunately, Japan has not protected this naming outside Japan, and we as restaurateurs have to deal with fake wagyu from Australia and the US. It is the equivalent of Sri Lanka or myself importing cattle from Australia and raising in Sri Lanka and stamping it as Australian beef. I hope in the respect of Japan and its contributions of making beef better, the meatpackers of Australia and the US should eventually, someday, refrain from using this word and exploiting this word representing the regal beef of Japan. I never went to chef school. I never worked in a hotel, restaurant, or a chef ever in my life. My lessons came from my father, who took me to great restaurants in Tokyo and South Asia. My mother, who taught me ingredients. And every mom and pop shop in Tokyo that I visited, who have shared the secrets and recipes as I gave them something from Sri Lanka, Sri Lankan tea. There's a small pouch of Sri Lankan tea on your seats today from Sri Lanka. After opening Nihonbashi in 1995, I hungered and strived to take Nihonbashi beyond its humble beginnings. A neighborhood sakana in Japan, or fishmonger, introduced me to Tsukiji fishmonger. And they took me to various specialist wholesalers, such as tuna mongers, unagi specialists, etc. To me, Tsukiji is fish heaven, because all good fish end up there. The bad ones are in hell. I'm really lucky to have this opportunity to have learned about fish species, seasonal catches, geographical influences, diets, and its impact on flavor from the best institution, Tsukiji. This place is truly magical at sunrise, and a must visit for all in our industry. If there is a mecca for chefs, this is it. The fish I hand carried were always specials, and were not required daily or in large quantities. The main ingredients of Nihonbashi are from Sri Lanka. Having access to fresh catch of the Indian Ocean, I carved out a menu from maguro, tai, hirame, tachiuo, katsuo, ika, mekajiki, makajiki, shitabirame, kawahagi, hata, aji, tako, to clams and oysters, all from our waters of our small island. If you look at Japanese restaurants in Asia, they are dependent on importing ingredients. Slicing gassed tuna and using charcoal briquettes and using frozen chicken. Of course, there are exceptions, but many fail to see Japanese cuisine is not about importing everything from Japan. Like Buddhism, washoku is a philosophy. It's about using what's around you. And that's the true essence of washoku. In this eternal quest to find better ingredients, I found one crucial ingredient that is the Sri Lankan crab. And from this, my second restaurant, the Ministry of Crab, was born. This restaurant set out to bring back and reconnect Sri Lanka to his great crustacean that was made famous in Singapore. The inception of this restaurant stems from one of my TV shows, an episode that was showcasing Sri Lankan crab, and the first half was filmed in Sri Lanka and the second half in Singapore. After the show aired, one of my friends asked me, why aren't you doing a crab restaurant? And the idea took shape and formed very fast. From there, the search for a ministerial building began, and the government of Sri Lanka invited me to take a look at a 350-year-old building in the heart of the city. Today, the Old Dutch Hospital has become the trendiest hotspot in Colombo. Ladies and gentlemen, meet Ministry of Crab. Crab restaurant. It's a menu highly focused and dedicated kitchen designed around my menu. Stand wok burners dish out over 160 crabs a day and has become almost cultish in nature. It's a fine dining restaurant without tablecloths or even cutlery. Like all restaurants in the beginning of time, MOC adopts a no freezer policy. All seafood comes to us in ice or alive. Sri Lanka's coastal miles and the size makes this all possible. And I cannot be more prouder to being able to do this day and age. We use Japanese knives, cooking utensils, chopsticks from Japanese kitchens, and a plethora of other Japanese kitchen utensils in our kitchen, reflecting my heritage, but also to be practical and precise. In our signature dish, we fuse Sri Lankan crabs, Japanese soy sauce, and olive oil, showcasing the unique background fur at the same time, creating a unique crab preparation. Also, we use dashi, made from locally sourced black pepper, dry chilies, for pepper crab and chili crab, respectively. We celebrate Sri Lanka's produce every day. The prawn curry at Ministry of Crab, which you saw briefly, is also interesting, as they use two species of prawns. No one in Sri Lanka does this kind of thing. One prawn is a freshwater prawn, weighing in at 200 grams, and the others are peels, black tigers. The fresh water prawn that we use is mainly for its dashi properties, and it gives depth into our curry of that dish. My partners are cricketers. I don't know whether you know this. Mahela Jayawardena and Kumar Sangakkara. They have represented and captained Sri Lanka in cricket. And I would like to believe I've done the same for Sri Lanka in sport of cooking. And together we have created a restaurant in Sri Lanka that looked inward and found out our best seafood. We give prominence to an ingredient that we are privileged to call ours and serve it in our shores. Where before us, for decades, we watched it fly away. We tread very low on food miles. We celebrate Sri Lankan ingredients, our heritage and culture, even designing the restaurant in a way that we did not disturb the building of 1700s. We are proud to have cooked in many cities from Tokyo to Sydney, presenting Sri Lankan gastronomy. And today I'm very, very humbled to share this story with you. Thank you. Very cool. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Darshan. Two more compelling reasons to visit Colombo, I think, for all of us. Do we have any questions from the floor? Raise your hand if you'd like to ask.
There's kind of been a global trend for restaurants that just serve one main ingredient. What do you think are the benefits of that kind of restaurant, like Ministry of Crab?
It was not a benefit or a trend that we are following. We are simply trying to reown the celebration of Sri Lankan crab. They have a saying in Sri Lanka that if you want to have our best crab, we have to fly to Singapore. So we had to fix that. So that was the biggest reason. But I think as a restaurant, when Paul was saying, reducing the offerings, we get to control what we serve, and it makes everything better. And it's actually not a global trend that's new. It's been in existence in Japan for the last 50, 60 years. We have paper restaurants, sushi restaurants, hotel restaurants, cafe restaurants.
Just to go back to Nihonbashi, when you opened 21 years ago, were the diners, the Sri Lankan diners, did they understand the Japanese cuisine and your philosophy, or did it take a long time to educate them, if you like?
I refuse to change anything because you're in a different country. And I learned that when I was in university in the US, the Japanese restaurants actually served a salad and miso soup in the very beginning of anything. And I was wondering why, and I realized that they were actually mirroring the continental concept of serving soup first. So at that time I decided if I ever open a restaurant, I will never do that. So in the beginning it was 99% Japanese guests. And it took a good 10 years for Sri Lankans to come up to the understanding of what we were doing. And it's always still a teaching process, and we are, I think, privileged to do that.
And now what sort of proportion of overseas visitors and Sri Lankan visitors do you have in both restaurants?
We are about one-third, Sri Lankans, Japanese, and overseas visitors.
Anything further, Darshan? Darshan Manudasan, thank you so much.